A mathematical function or a signal represented as a series of samples, a time continuous signal that has been sampled into a sequence of numbers, can be analyzed from its frequency content based on mathematical methods that were developed by two French mathematicians, Laplace and Fourier. They were living from the year of middle of 1700 until the middle of the 1800, and they both were working on methods for analyzing frequency content of a function, meaning for in the perspective of a signal that you can analyze a signal both in the time domain, but then you apply this frequency analysis method and you can analyze the frequency also in its frequency domain. So let us continue now with a very simple example where I will try to visualize what this is all about. We see here on this picture three different waveforms, sine waves, the first one with 100 Hz frequency, second 300 and the third 500 Hz, and they have like decreasing amplitudes. And now I would like to add these sine waves together and see what could possibly be the result. And in the first case, using just two components, then we will have here something that more or less starts to look like a square wave. Of course, you have this still the shape of some kind of sine wave, but it starts to look more and more like a sine wave. And then you add three components, all three of them, and they start to look more and more like a sine wave, and more like a square wave. And if you would add maybe like five or ten of these sine wave components with the right combination, you could have a representation that would very well look like a square wave, or any other kinds of waveform for that matter, also triangular wave or whatever. The example that I just showed you was three different sine waves that we composed together, and we were able to see that we could generate another waveform that looks more like a square wave, a periodic signal. And indeed we can analyze any kind of periodic signal. It could be a square wave, could be a triangle wave or whatever, and it is possible to analyze it from a series of sine wave and cosine wave expansion, the Fourier series expansion. And this method was actually the major scientific contribution from this French mathematician Fourier. Now, I mean, there are more complex signals than just these periodic, well-defined mathematical functions. If you look at this picture here, we have a non-deterministic, seems to be a very noisy signal. And we can then suspect that this signal could contain a large variety of frequencies, must be a very complex combination of sine wave and cosine wave that makes up this complex signal. And indeed, if we analyze the composition of frequencies being this amplitude spectra according to the Laplace-Fourier transform theory, then we will find a function that corresponds to something like this. Most likely a bandwidth limited noisy signal in this case. And this was on the previous picture, it was a continuous function, this frequency transform. And this is what we can see here also in this diagram. The line here is a continuous function in the frequency domain. But then if we sample this a time continuous signal at n number of samples, then the corresponding frequency transform according to the discrete Fourier transform will also be limited to n number of samples. So it will generate n number of samples also in the frequency domain when you apply the discrete free transform. And the discrete free transform is a mathematical formula that is developed to be able to compute the free transform analysis also using computers. It's a way of limiting the computational complexity, sometimes also using a fast algorithm called FFT that you might be aware of or have heard about. So the time discrete Fourier transform DFT is computed on n samples of a time discrete signal and shows an analysis of the signal frequency spectra. And this spectra is also then represented by n number of equally spaced frequencies called channels. So each one of these frequency positions where we compute the discrete Fourier transforms, those positions are called channels. And fast Fourier transform FFT is an efficient algorithm for computing this DFT, as we said before. But how then will the response be for a single sine wave frequency if it is residing exactly on one of the channels, or if it is residing somewhere here in between the channels? If it is residing exactly on the channels, then one could expect that the response would be exactly the amplitude. But what happens is if this sine wave frequency is somewhere here in between those two channels, how will the response be like? Well, for the single frequency, it will be like we expected, that there is only one of these channels that are responding to this singular sine wave component. But on the other hand, if it is residing somewhere in between those channels, then the response will very well be spread along the adjacent neighboring channels. But you shouldn't worry too much about this, because there are ways to also control the response of those spurious responses on the side lobes. What is recommended to do is to apply a window function, and the window function is this kind of function that will decrease its amplitude when it reaches the border of the sample interval. So in the middle of the interval, that's where you have the maximum amplitude, and when you're reaching the end of the sample and at the beginning of the data sample, then the amplitude is reaching zero. And you are multiplying this window function with the data before you actually apply the Fourier transform for the frequency analysis. And after multiplication, then if you have you can think that you have a single sine wave, in this case 765 hertz, then you apply this window function, and after this multiplication, the amplitude will look like this. And it is this function then that you are feeding to the Fourier transform analysis. So what kind of impact will this have on the spurious responses then, since I have promised you already that this is a way of controlling this problem? We can have a look at this slide. All of these cases was for using one single sinus waveform, and this is the response that you can get for not using any window function at all, just computing the Fourier transform directly on the set of data samples. And this is using something called the Hunting window, the Humming window, and the Bartlett. Bartlett, Humming, and Hunting, those are all names of guys who came up with different kinds of shapes of those window functions. But what we can see here in the frequency domain is that some of these functions, they give a very narrow main lobe where it has the sensitivity to frequency response, but it has maybe more also response of the side lobes. But on the other hand, you could have maybe a wider main lobe, but the responses on the side lobes are then very low. So different windows created by different men here, or maybe women also for that matter. represents different trade-offs between the response of the main lobe and the response of the side lobe. This is an example. It's a signal that constitutes out of two frequencies, 10.855 kilohertz and 11.300 kilohertz. And it's a very noisy signal that has a signal-to-noise ratio of about 15 decibels. And the higher frequency, F2 on 11.3 kHz, has a very low amplitude and can hardly be found in the frequency analysis when no window is used. So here you have the first frequency, and the F2 is residing somewhere here, but it's kind of difficult, you know, to distinguish between the first frequency component and also with this noise present. And now we are applying the humming window before we do this free transform analysis, and all of a sudden the response of the side lobe seems to be less of impact, such that it is possible also to see and clearly detect the second frequency component of the signal. But still, of course, the noise is present. So one can conclude this from this, that selecting the best window function is always a compromise. And if you want to be able to see two frequencies components having almost the same frequency, a badly chosen window function will then cause the two components to look like one. Sampling without windowing can also in some cases be the best choice. If you want to find a single frequency component with low amplitude, a window function such as Hanning can be a good choice. The Hamming window can be a good compromise between the two objectives, narrow bandwidth of the main frequency lobe and also low level response of the spurious responses from the side lobes. This video presentation was about frequency analysis. And frequency analysis is important because we very often would like to see and analyze frequency both in the time domain as well as also in its frequency domain. So we use mathematical methods that was developed by French mathematicians Laplace and Fourier. I also introduced to you the concept of using window functions in order to control the phenomenon of channel leakage. Channel leakage was related to spurious responses on neighboring channels in the discrete Fourier transform. These are some basic concepts and understanding that I was trying to introduce to you without requiring that you have knowledge about Laplace and Fourier transforms in your previous courses. So thank you for your attention.